one guy who just saved my ass. I didn't catch his name, but he indeed did give me a mic that worked. This is my Q&A panel. I should also be doing some kind of, I'm doing a thing on Sunday night called Brentalfloss Late Night. They haven't told me what the rules are, so I'm not sure. Say again. I did promise burlesque, so...
There are no rules.
Wah, wah, wah. Wah, wah, wah. Yeah, I'm sure everybody came here to see this.
The rules of Alcon,
there
is no rules.
All my beautiful curves. Jiggling, jiggling like a hairy jello pie. Anyway. Yeah.
Jiggle physics.
So, I'd like to just put a disclaimer up at the beginning. I usually am jet-lagged when I arrive at Alcon. However, if you know my friend Dave Bulmer, a.k.a. Demon Tomato Dave, I've been staying with him and his lovely wife at their flat in Manchester for a few days, and basically Dave and I are both nerds about obscure things, and when I hang out with him, we stay up all night like schoolgirls in a slumber party just talking about weird stuff. And so I'm very underslept, so I've been doing this thing where, I mean to say one word, but my brain does this kind of like backward thesaurus thing.
I do that too.
So if it happens, and you've got a drink in your hand, drink. It just won't make a game out of it. Anyway, this is... Oh, you've got a horn. Nice. I've always wanted a drink out of a horn.
Bring me cover!
Anyway, so I'd love to take your questions, and I'd love to give you some answers if you have them. Not all at once, yes. What is my favorite game soundtrack? Oh, that's so hard. You know, the thing about game soundtracks is like, I don't know if anyone's favorite has to do with actual subjective or rather objective music quality. It's kind of like the game that found its way into your heart, like some weird space age Star Trek liquid that just got in there in your aortas and went, you like me a lot. I think Final Fantasy IV is really good.
Hey!
But it's because I love Final Fantasy IV. I think it's got the best field theme, but of course everybody likes Terra from Final Fantasy VI's field theme. So, I mean, I know this is a dodge, but like, what a hard question. Which of my Brady Bunch kids do I love most, you know? The one that's adopted, thank you. Thank you, front row, pinch hitting. Yeah, Final Fantasy IV today, maybe tomorrow, Chrono Trigger. Actually, I respect Chrono Trigger a lot. I'm not sure I like it the most. Mega Man 2 and 3 are top-notch. I really like the Phoenix Wright, the first Phoenix Wright game.
Objection!
Overruled. My question is, this door makes me worry that I'm bleeding into there and that's bleeding into here. Does anybody have a problem with it being closed? Is there anyone on staff in earshot?
Tobe, close it.
All right, well, you know, if somebody wanted to shut it, I wouldn't say no. Shut it, shut it, shut it, shut it, shut it, shut it, shut it. Woo! Thank you. Give it up for our door shutter. Thank you. Much appreciated. All right, thanks for the question. I'm not always good at favorites and least favorites, but those are actually the favorite questions. What is this drink? Is it one of the things you get in a Zelda game?
This is the pitcher of courage. You've completed this castle. Now,
get totally drunk with this. Now you're ready to defeat Ganondorf. There aren't really two of them, it just seems to be, because you drank the whole thing. Yes, question.
What's your favorite console?
What's my favorite console? Super Nintendo. Done. Dunsky.
There you
go. Front row.
You said you're a fan of Phoenix Wright games. Are you a fan of the Miles Edgeworth investigation games?
The question is, am I a fan of the Miles Edgeworth games? I have honestly not played them. The thing is, like, I've got this thing that happens when a big part of your job becomes playing games, and, like, you start to judge whether you want to play a game based less on whether you love it and more on whether you can make something out of it. And I knew I could make something out of the Phoenix Wright games, but like, I didn't necessarily want to follow up with Apollo Justice, Miles Edgeworth, but I would like to play them one day. I just haven't yet. So the answer is not that I dislike, just that I'm ignorant of the games as experiences. Yes?
Now that you've been in
a creator on Patreon for a while. Do you feel it's affected your creation process for new pieces of music?
The question, very good question, thank you. The question is, now that I'm on Patreon and have been for a little over a year, has that affected my creation process? I'm going to answer with two things. Number one, this has been a very different year than last year because in February I got an idea for a video game and I've been developing it on and off ever since. So, my output of Brentalfloss videos this year has been markedly slower and less frequent than last year. That said, here is how it affects my creation process. It's a bit cynical, but it's the truth. I don't do the monthly Patreon thing because I don't want people to pay the same amount if I don't do any work one month or if I do a lot more the next month. It's what makes more sense, like when I crank out the thing that you have signed up for, then you pay me. This is a pretty good deal, yeah? But it rolls over at the end of the month. You get paid. You guys can hold your hands up all you want. I'm just gonna keep talking, the pace of talking. Maybe your armpit was a little sore. Ah, I see, all right. So the way it affects the process is on Patreon, if I make a video at any time during the month, doesn't matter what time of the month I make the video, I get paid at the beginning of the following month. So if it's the end of the month and I haven't made a video, I have a choice of make one really fast and get paid in 2 days, or make one slightly slower and get paid in 33 days. So I will be honest with you and say Dragon Warrior with lyrics was, frankly, a bit of a rush job because I could and did use the cash. And I had a convention the next day, so I basically was up till 3 a.m. finishing it in order to get it in under the deadline and get the Patreon money sooner rather than in 30-something days. Other than that, I don't think it's affected the process much because when you have a good idea, when I have a good idea, it's still a good idea. The only effect has been deciding that it's a better time to go ahead and do it because of that oncoming deadline. Thanks for the question.
Dragon Warrior is still really good.
Say what?
Dragon Warrior is still really
thank you. I thought the middle bit was a bit slow, and I wish that I hadn't used the real F-bombs, but anyway. It just wasn't worth it. If you're going to use the real F-word, fine. But do it because it's really the... You know what I mean? Because you have to. Anyway. Hey, how's it going? Faces I recognize. Anywho. Hello. Question. A question and a compliment. Thanks, who's that? I've been compared to a guy who did music for Simpsons and Futurama. Thank you. Very nice of you to say. Your question was, what was one of the more complicated processes to make a video or a song? Well, here's the thing. So barbershop quartet music. Barbershop quartet music is like, has more maths in it than other kinds of music. It is, if you don't get the math right, it doesn't sound like barbershop. It sounds like four guys singing. So the Bioshock Infinite song, which I really wanted to be in that barbershop style, basically was so much experimentation, so much trial and error. There are three distinct recordings of the song, and I only liked the last one. Part of that was having four different characters. If you notice, the tenor in that song sounds like somebody grabbed Kermit the Frog's nuts and squeezed. Sure, yeah. Like, I mean, basically, I needed that tenor to have a distinct sound on top. So he's got this, like this thing. And I had to contort my body to get those notes out. But now you've got four different people singing out of my mouth. Because you guys may not know this, but I have a little sound booth that's got wooden slats, it bolts together. And sometimes to get the right sound out, I have to like lunge into the mic or like do these weird contort, like I hold onto this piece of wood and basically that one like was a nightmare, but also a fun nightmare because then I had, anyway, it was fine. So the answer to your question is probably one of the more complicated processes of making a tune or a video was Bioshock Infinite because of the barbershop. Yes.
Edited version of the video, as you see. How many periods did you generally go through? Like,
Well, the question is, how many beers? Now, you mean specifically Karioma, or just the Game Drunks video?
Karioma.
So I do a video series called Game Drunks, and it's ill-conceived, but I like my friend Brett very much, and we have fun when we do that. And the question is, how much do I really drink? Honestly, the early videos where I'm getting drunk and playing games, the answer is a lot. These ones lately, not as much, because like, it's two things. I don't necessarily want to create an example for kids where it's like, hey, the only way to have fun playing games is to get dangerously shit-faced. And also, I'm 31. Like, there's no, you know, like when you're 10, there's value in telling your friend you beat a game on hard mode. For me, I don't get anything for telling my friend I beat alcohol on hard mode. You know, just making it through the game and watching the end on YouTube is what I do with games now, and it's kind of the same with alcohol. Like, I'll have a few drinks, but, and get loose, but really, the format of that thing we do, occasionally and with very comparatively low views, is just as a format to put a frame around gaming and talking about stuff. Because, like, it has crossover, or rather, it shares elements with Game Grumps, but it's so not. And we are not really, I'm not trying to be Aaron and John, but anyway, the answer to your question is, lately we're not drinking anywhere as much as it even looks like we are, just because we don't really desire to get super shit-faced as adults. Yeah. Yeah, I don't actually recommend making... The thing about drinking games is it sort of implies that you need either an excuse or some outside force making you drink. And it's like... Yeah, it's like, do you want to drink? Okay, drink. Do you not want to drink? Okay, do not drink. It's kind of like... I don't know. There were people in college. I went to Oklahoma, OU, where in 2002... I feel like, you know, as much as we already had a fairly comparatively progressive society, well, Oklahoma is always 30 years behind that. And plenty of, you know, like I was in the drama school, plenty of the gay guys who were totally straight until they had one sip of Boone's Farm, which is like this, you know, the brightest colors that exist outside nature, like that. Boone's Farm is that. They get a bottle of this, it's like 3% alcohol, they have a sip, and suddenly they're into boys. It's like, suddenly a completely virginal preacher's daughter has one sip and suddenly she's into sex. Wow. But like, it's an excuse to do things that really you were interested in anyway, but now, and I feel like drinking games kind of evolved from that kind of thing, where it's like, you need a external excuse to drink. And drinking games can be fun, but just like, I'm just gonna say, I don't endorse the idea of drinking to the point where you're poisoning yourself, because you can die, and that's no fun. Anyway, you've been holding your hand up for such a long time. You're asking if I thought about doing yet even more DuckTales with lyric songs. Thought about it, yes. I feel like it's diminishing returns at this point. The Amazon was pretty fun, but it was the same kind of jokes as the moon. I feel like Transylvania from DuckTales would be a fun Halloween, like Flosstober video, but I'm not sure if it's gonna happen anytime soon. I'm actually considering, and I can't believe I'm saying this because I'm so sick of hearing about these fucking games, I'm thinking about a Five Nights at Freddy's video. We're flossed over. Yeah. Anyway, Mohawk, hit me.
Yeah, we all know your influences by video games, but who are your musical influences?
Who are my musical influences? Well, and if you don't count video game music, which I think there's a fair amount in my musical DNA, I would say piano rockers like Elton John, Billy Joel, Ben Folds. Yeah. Just tons of the Beatles. There was a Beatles radio station, an all-Beatles radio station on AM radio from my 7th through 8th grade year. It didn't last long, believe it or not. But steeped in the Beatles. Dr. Demento, which is stuff like Weird Al and Spike Jones. Old Spike Jones with an S, not the director. Lots of musical theater. The Disney Renaissance, Aladdin, Beauty and the Beast, Lion King, Little Mermaid. To a lesser extent, Hercules, Pocahontas, Hunchback. Musicals like Little Shop of Horrors, Phantom, Les Mis, all the kind of breast milk musicals that before you get into the good stuff, it's like, yeah, everybody likes Phantom when they're young. Everybody likes Les Mis at some point. You have that phase. So, yeah, that's a pretty good list, but I'm sure there's more. Thanks. Say again? Have I seen the producers? Yes, a musical written by a man who's not a composer, but rather sang into a tape. And he's funny and old enough that they went, look, he's Mel Brooks. Let's just make a musical out of these weird tapes he made. And it won all the Tonys ever. Yeah, I'm familiar with that one. What do you think of it?
Love it.
Love it. Well, it's a great movie, the original. I think the stage show is really fun. What kills me about it, as a musical theater writer, which is kind of my training, like my pre-Brentalfloss life, I wish the tunes were better. I wish that it was a more hummable score. But like, he really just, like, into a tape recorder was like, that face. And like they went, okay, we've got to trick people into thinking that this was written for an orchestra. You know what I mean? Like they kind of just took that one line of melody and like wrapped an entire orchestration and choral arrangement around it. But the songs are just okay. It's the comedy that makes it good. Anyway, snuck in a question under the bell. How'd you do that? Spider-Man. What gave you the idea to use babies as the subject for the Mario Kart 8 video?
Yeah.
Good question. I actually wrote almost 2 full drafts of Mario Kart with lyrics before I got to that. I didn't ever like them because it's really hard to sum up a franchise, especially one that changes so much each time. Like, most of the Phoenix Wright games, if you've watched my Phoenix Wright with lyrics, yeah, they mostly refer to the first 3, but the mechanics didn't really change dramatically. Whereas in Mario Kart, the difference between Mario Kart 1 and 8 is dramatic. So I started writing a thing about all of the irresponsibility of Mario Kart 8. And then I thought, really, the main thing about this is it's irresponsible is just the babies. Like, yeah, we're littering everywhere. We're invading a Yoshi sanctuary, a wild animal sanctuary, where we will drop banana peels, break shells that may or may not be sharp and dangerous. The Yoshis can eat those. I'm not sure how I feel about that. We're gonna squirt blooper goo all over the ground and set fires with bombs, which we let babies throw, and we throw at babies.
And a blue shell.
There's a blue spiky shell that rams into babies at like 60 kilometers an hour. I said kilometers. Oh wait, you guys use miles, fucking.
How dare you!
I've just been in Norway, and they actually are fully metric there. You guys are like metric when you feel like it, and then in the car you forgot how to be metric. I don't know what's going on. Say again? And electrocuting babies. Yeah, there's a lot of things that, like, basically, to me, babies as a thing are just, it's just funny if it's a baby. I don't know why. Say again? I love when you help me answer my question. This is great. The what? Oh, the pee fountain. Yes. The possibly urine, possibly... What else could it be? It's so yellow. Anyway, like, it's not lemonade. I've seen lemonade. This is like...
Probably lemonade. Yeah.
Say again? Could be cider, but it's not. It's pee. It's we. Anyway, yes, ma'am.
I'm sure everyone enjoyed your little comic that you were doing with the Brewmaker 7 years ago. Have you ever thought about expanding your media into different products?
So the question is about the webcomic that I did for a bit there, that is no more, and whether or not I've thought about expanding into other media. Yes, but maybe not in the way you're thinking. So Brentalfloss as a media umbrella, it's like, if you ask what it's about, well, the With Lyrics series is one thing, and me sitting here talking to you is another thing, and me doing live shows is slightly different, but, like, it's not as if I have, like, a... It's not... I don't think, actually, Brentalfloss really adapted itself as a character well to comic, which is why toward the end of the comic, it was way less about these character versions of us and more about a one-off joke about video games, which is what I was doing all along anyway. With that in mind, I am working on a video game. I so wish that I had the prototype with me because we could literally play it together. It's a party game called Use Your Words. And basically, imagine an interactive Cards Against Humanity. Cards Against Humanity makes you feel like you're funny because it gives you the answers to a fill in the blank. But, what was I saying again? I still can't hear you, but okay. Whatever you said is brilliant. So the concept of Use Your Words is you get a fill in the blank, and you fill it in. But rather, instead of it being written down or using a card, it works kind of like the Jackbox Party Pack, where your phone or tablet or any internet-enabled device talk to your TV. So you've got it on your Xbox One, PS4, PC, maybe a Roku. It's on your TV. You grab your smartphone or your tablet or even your 3DS, and now that's your controller via Wi-Fi or satellite internet. So you fill in the blank of this thing, and it's just the point of the game is that it's a way, everybody likes to be funny and joke with their friends. Nobody's ever quite gamified that in a console. But the fact that you can essentially text your answers in, and it's not just fill in the blank, it's also write your own subtitle to this foreign film clip, put a headline on this newspaper, things like that. And it's basically just like, the slogan is a game for funny people and their unfunny friends. And that's kind of our goal, is to make it not just fun for clever people, but also if you've got like really super clever funny woman and her boyfriend didn't want to come to this party, doesn't know anybody, our goal is to make it where if you play this game, he's having fun too. So cross your fingers, it'll be coming out by the end of the year. That is probably the best example of how I'm looking to branch out into other media. Thanks for the question. Yes? Did performing at the Norwegian Convention provide its own challenges? Are you ready to hear this?
Yeah!
Story time!
I'd say I'm pro-gay. I'd say I'm pro-trans. The question in Norway is, how pro-trans are you? Because we're not often made to be put in the spotlight and prove in a kind of binary yes-no way whether or not it's easy just to abstractly say, yeah, that's fine, or stand up for it. So, picture, I'm in Norway, I'm jet-lagged, I'm making decent money selling merchandise, there's a pretty good line going, I'm shaking hands, I'm kind of nervous about the show coming up in 2 hours. Because this is the first time I'd ever done a show where the English wasn't the first language of the country. They all know English, but it's different, right? Like, it could be, and also I wasn't as familiar with the culture. I feel like UK culture, I've got a pretty good handle on. I mean, you guys are our cultural parents, right? It's just going to visit mom and dad. So I'm there, right? And I'm in line, and here comes this trans woman, i.e. anatomically born a man, but is a woman. I'm all good with that. I'll be honest with you, quite pushy, touches my beard, and here's the thing, it's the only hair on my head. Don't touch it. But like kind of mussing it, and like we're kind of laughing about it, but the inside version of me is going, I wish I could disinfect my beard, but whatever. Like, not because of anything in particular, just because I don't like that. But I'm going, you know what? I don't want to somehow make it seem like this is the reason. Like, that, oh, you're trans, and that's why I'm grossed out. That's not the problem. This is a pushy person, right? So, here we go. She's like, it's so great to listen to your podcast, you're pro-trans. I'm like, absolutely. She's like, I'm trans and gay because I'm a lesbian. I'm like, great, awesome. Whatever blows your dress up, let's have a good time, live your life. And she's like, yeah, would you take me on stage with you and stand next to me and say that people shouldn't say certain things about trans and gay people online? And like, it just hit me like, so okay, time stops. What she's asked me to do is, in the middle of my raunchy, you know, kind of mean humor show. I mean, Brentalfloss is not, I'm not mean, but in the moment of a Brentalfloss show, it's all kind of like, it's the kind of humor that's not Mr. Rogers. It's not patting anybody on the back. It's basically showing everybody the elephant in the room. And this question just hits me, and I don't see my life flash before my eyes. I see my death on Tumblr flash before my eyes. And I think, okay, here's a pushy person who I wouldn't associate with, and that has nothing to do with sexuality or gender identity. But I was not enjoying this conversation, and yet now I'm faced with, will you essentially prove to me and everyone that you stand by this community enough to say that in the middle of your otherwise raunchy, dick and fart humor show? And I said, of course, yeah, yeah. And internally going like, how am I going to do this? So when you ask, were there special challenges in Norway? The thing is, I'm not wanting to conflate pushy or annoying with any kind of gender identity because I feel like they're independent. But it was scary because my fear was, are Norwegians on board with this? She told me that she'd been like beat up and at one point actually stabbed in the street probably for being trans. And I'm sitting here like, it was kind of blackmail. But I'm not saying like, this is what trans people do. No, it's more like I just was faced with this ultimate final exam of, are you a progressive thinker or are you a progressive person? Anyway, this is not me patting myself on the back. This is me trying to share the drama that I couldn't share there because I didn't want it to get back to her that like, you know, it was just like, I didn't want to do it. I didn't. But I started to think about why don't I want to do it? And it was fear. It was fear of the audience's reaction. So I did it. Of course, she acted surprised. But whatever. Anyway, like that was kind of like, this was your idea, but whatever. Anyway. So that was you guys, nobody wants to laugh right now because you're uncomfortable, because this is an uncomfortable thing we're all learning about. The point is, it was fun, it's funny to me now, but I was scared shitless that I was going to stick my neck out, and suddenly this thing that I thought would have been otherwise unnecessary during my show, which is just not themed around that, you know? Kind of like throwing some ketchup in a marshmallow sundae. Like, ketchup's great, why? But it went fine. And so yeah, anyway, I think trans people and gay people are great. The end. and all the LGBT quilt bag, whatever you can be. If you're that, that's great. Question.
A year ago, you talked about the original Super Mario theme being a theme that you were afraid to do because of the sort of fear of it being like the end of your career. Now that you've done sort of a silly take on it, has that changed your feelings on doing something with that theme and equally, is there now a different theme that you're scared to do something?
Wow, good question. Okay, so I did say for a long time that I wasn't going to do the original Super Mario Brothers theme because that was such an obvious thing to do and like, for a lot of reasons. I just felt like that would be the end of Brentalfloss. Like it's sort of doing Mickey Mouse with lyrics. There's so much to talk about. How could you ever really do a lyric that kind of like lived up to the entirety of Mario? But then for an April Fool's gag, I thought it'd be funny, if you didn't see the video, I thought it'd be funny to do a video where I did the Mario theme with Japanese lyrics. And the joke is that it's basically horribly translated and horribly misunderstood. So it's, you know, like Mario, the red mustache man, he finds the sewer coins, turtles fear him. These were the subtitles in the video, which otherwise was correctly translated at great... it was not easy to do, to translate and make it scan. But the question is there now a song that I am now afraid to do? And I'm gonna answer your question in a slightly different way. I feel like now doing a Sonic with lyrics is kind of the next thing to either commit to at my own peril or subvert. I just didn't really love Sonic growing up, and whether or not I loved the game has not ever really been a barrier to entry. It's just that like I have neither love nor hate for Sonic, and I feel like everybody who loves Sonic is kind of like, there's so often questions about it that it's almost like, you know when you surprise people, if I surprise people with a video, they're pleasantly surprised. If they've been waiting for something, there's pressure on it. And it's like, if I make fun of Sonic, then it's like, he hated it all along, he's a jerk, I love Sonic, or whatever. Like, but to me, doing a proper Sonic with lyrics is the next big, like, I don't know how I would, but moreover, I don't want it to be, if I do it, I do want it to be worth the wait, and that is the challenge. Thanks for the question. Somebody I haven't called on yet, yes? Have I had any issues with, based on the copyright is what you're asking, with Nintendo on YouTube? I have not, so far. But And I'll be honest with you, I'm not exactly sure why that is, but I think it's mostly because what I do is, in fact, it's parody. I think it's selling games, frankly, most of the time. Sometimes I'm just taking the piss, and you can tell I don't like a game, but most of the time, the net effect is somebody's going to get on their virtual console and go, oh, I didn't know this Earthbound thing, and I guess I can buy it on, or whatever the game is. Super Mario Land 2, I think, is a good example. I love that game, and it's a game that a lot of you guys, if you're 15, well, you wouldn't be 15, but if you're 18, 20 years old now, you were not alive to play Super Mario Land 2. So how would you know about it? But, like, but to answer your question, they haven't really come after me
yet,
except once or twice when I've used the original music from the game, and I've used it without adding my own lyrics, where it's like just a background tune. Sometimes instead of them, they don't shut down the video, but they kind of just, I can't monetize it. And it seems like maybe what's actually happening is they're monetizing it. But considering the people that have gotten royally fucked by that kind of, you know, switcheroo, like, oh, we're gonna start suing you now, or we're gonna start shutting you down now, I feel like I've been pretty lucky. So, no complaints there. Yes? Thank you. This question was about the podcast that I do that has nothing to do with Brentalfloss, which I'd love to talk about, called Trends Like These. It's a podcast where we round up a choice selection of trending news stories on the internet, and we just discuss them, my friend Travis and I. If you read Brentalfloss the comic, Travis is the human being that the character of Travis was based on. And we just do a podcast about that. You can get it on iTunes. And the question was, how did it get started? Travis sent me an email saying, Brent, we've been dancing around this for years. It's time to do a podcast. Which is weird because we have not ever danced around it. He asked me once back in the day. I said no. And then he went off and made a world famous podcast with his brothers that now gets like 500,000 downloads a week. So it's called My Brother, My Brother and Me. It's way better than Trends Like These. Go check it out. Anywho... Yeah, it was just him saying, let's try it. I was like, no, 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 no. He was like, yes, 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 yes. No infinity. Yes, double infinity. And so I was so nervous to be me on a podcast that I actually am not ashamed now to say I got high before the first three episodes. Because if you've got anxiety, like, I'm just gonna come out and say it. If you've got anxiety, don't smoke the anxiety-causing stuff, but like the mellow stuff might be better for you than some meds that, you know, some chemicals that somebody cooked up in a lab. I'm just saying. Room silent. Can't talk about it. All right, well, weed's fine in moderation. There. Hey, sorry, are you okay? Okay, sorry. I can't believe I did that to you, Mike. Anyway, so what was I talking about? That's the weed is what made me not remember. What? Podcast and weed. Great combination. Travis's entire career right now is he is a professional podcaster. He's got simultaneously six going, and I was his fourth. Ours was his fourth. We did two pilot episodes, which are now, will be kind of like behind the scenes goodies one day, because they're comparatively, you know, they're just a proto matter of what we ended up doing. But, you know, and it's scary for me because I feel like Brentalfloss, especially on stage and in videos, like this, me right now is like, a slightly Brentalfloss favoring version of just me, right? Like, we're talking about Brentalfloss, so I'm a little bit, but like, this is me. But like, the Brentalfloss videos and stage persona are like Mr. Hyde, and Trends Like These Brent, which is more or less me, but like in a journalistic political environment, is like Dr. Jekyll. And it was very scary to me to like, have those both in the same media at once. But I just started to figure out slowly but surely that everybody realizes that when I'm goofy as Brentalfloss, it's not like I walk around adding lyrics to things in life. It's an act, it's a gag, right? And I wish I trusted my audience sooner to know the difference. So thank you so much for the question. Yes?
As long as I'm back here, you're actually...
possibly save to get from season there for about an hour ready.
Say again?
Yeah.
Okay, so we do this bit in the podcast. So, okay, there's a show, there's an American news show that goes back decades called 60 Minutes. And they always all say their names. I'm Mike Wallace. I'm Brian Williams. I'm Peggy Doodah. I'm Clippity Jib Jibs. And it's like, they all just, it's like, and this is 60 Minutes. And so we just wanted to have that kind of thing for our, like, newsy show. But there's two of us. So we just thought it'd be funny to every episode make up a third person. In the first episode, we did a segment about cosmic rays. So it was like, I'm Brent Black. I'm Travis McElroy,
and I'm Cosmic Ray.
And it was like, then we had a thing that we do every time. And so we wait till the end of the episode to make it rhyme, and to make the intro rhyme, and to make that part of it make sense. But like, that's where that came from, and it just stuck. And we now have so many bits we have to do every time, like the Brent did I forget anything, and I have to come up with something that I forgot that we're gonna go do now. It's all bullshit, but it's fun. Say again? Usually, if you notice, Travis usually is the one doing the, saying most of the stuff in the wrap-up, like the check us out on Facebook. Usually I'm frantically trying to write something that's kind of related to what we've been talking about, but casual enough, but it's rarely, it's like 30 seconds before, but it's not completely on the fly. I'd love to say I'm a good improviser, but I'm really only a good improviser when I've got an audience, because they only laugh and clap typically. They don't actually provide another variable. That's the secret. People that are afraid of audiences and public speaking, the irony is an audience is actually a silent partner if you're halfway good. The only time they're scary is if you're fucking up. Anyway, just so you know, less anxiety. Marijuana. Yes, you.
Oh, you're so quiet and polite.
Great question. The thing is, I dropped my wallet. Jesus Christ. I'm going to need that. Thank you. I don't know how. I know I'm not losing weight. That's not the reason.
Okay. For alcohol!
Say what?
For alcohol.
For alcohol. Oh, like my wallet was just jumping out of my ass? Like, I'm going to go buy you some alcohol. I have a possessed demon wallet.
Because you need it.
This is how things work in the UK?
Yep.
See you later. You're going to buy you some milk. Yeah, that's how things work. Full of your weird bills of different colors and sizes. What the hell was I talking about? Oh, sorry. Jesus. Thanks again.
You're welcome.
So the question was, I have stated that I think that I sometimes sell games, in as much as if a game, you know, was part of my childhood and now you can buy it on the virtual console, maybe some kid discovers it through me. A lot of people said that they never played Cave Story until they saw my lyrics, or they'll ask me, which Mega Man should I buy on the virtual console, which tells me, they're asking me because they saw the video, right? But the question was, if I was approached by a company that wanted me to do sort of a brand deal, do like a paid with lyrics. And the thing is, I'm not sure I'm at liberty to say which, but I've been approached, and I typically, if you've seen the movie Wayne's World, this is really, typically this is my philosophy. I don't like to shill for anything, except myself. So like, the idea of doing a fun lyric for a game that just came out that may or may not be good is frightening. Because I feel like if I have anything, it's authenticity. People can hate my opinion or think I'm an asshole, but I don't think, they should never think I've lied to them, is what I'm saying. Well, yeah, I don't want to take on a project that would negatively impact the authenticity factor. Which, what I mean by that is this. I think that I've given up a lot and sacrificed a lot to maintain a certain level of honesty. By that I mean, I could have been shilling for a lot of things by now. There's a lot of opportunity cost to the fact that I am subversive. But the thing is that, like, I feel like if there's anything in my personality that really comes out in the work, it's subverting the powers that be. Because even if I'm telling you how great this game is, I'm still kind of taking the piss at the same time. And I feel like that kind of honesty you know, I think I've, if nothing else, earned the trust of the audience. So the only, like, it would really be a shame to cash that in for one payment of here's $5,000 to do our shitty new game, do a song about it. And the thing is, they probably wouldn't like my draft because I'd probably be making fun of the game. Some people thought that I had a brand deal for Shovel Knight because it actually, my Shovel Knight with lyrics video came out 6 days after they released the game. It so happens that I played it and beat it in the first 24 hours, well, 36 hours that it was out. Vert, who's the composer of the game, gave me the files with which he made the music, so that made for a very fast turnaround process. But the thing is, like, if I'd played Shovel Knight and beat it, and that day they'd been like, hey, will you make it with lyrics for us? We'll pay you. I'd have been like, fuck yeah! But the thing is, only because I played it, right? So the short answer to your question is, I don't think I'm the right choice for most branding deals, because if I'm gonna be a shill for something, it's gonna be because I already liked it and already wanted to share it, and pretty much for no other reason. Thanks for asking. Yes?
It's been a while since you've put out any of your sort of non-video game musical-related content. Do you have any of that you've either done personally or that you've done with the future maybe putting out?
The question is, it's been a while since I've released non-video game-related music. And would I be, am I considering putting out some of that soon? To be quite honest with you, my hope, and the thing is, I have lots of hopes, lots of them don't work out. My hope for this next 2 years of my life is that this game I'm working on sells enough. I'm not looking to get rich, it's not a $1 million game, but let's say that it buys me a year. And in that year, I mean, I don't want to name names and get you excited, but like, I've had very serious talks with collaborators of mine that you've heard of about writing a full-length stage musical. I've had very serious discussions with friends about cool ideas for different things. Like, I am in love with the music of Ben Folds, particularly the early Ben Folds 5 stuff. And I love emulating other people's styles, and I've got a friend who sounds a lot like early Ben Folds. So I thought it would be fun to do an EP called Brent Folds 4. Where it's an EP of songs that I've written in the style of Ben Folds that my friend who sounds like him sings. So basically you're just happening upon a lost album of Ben Folds. So Ben Folds fans can almost, even though they know it's not really him, it's like they get the experience of like B-sides they've never heard before from back in the old days when they had a three-piece band. Which, yes, I know it's the Ben Folds 5. It was weird. Anyway, that's an example. Another example is, just weird stuff I want to do. My old sound engineer, Joe, who was my engineer and arranger on the first two albums, we've been kicking around an idea for years called 1980X, which is like the idea of an EP of lost hits from the 80s. But instead of it being like, we're making fun of the 80s, no. It would be like actually legit great songs with singers that still have that 80s sound, i.e. not me, that Whitesnake sound, or that Poison sound, or that, you know, like all of the British, like there's this sort of sound of the British invasion in the 80s that's like, like that thing, you know what I'm talking about? Yeah, there's a lot of that. Just this like, oh, I'm doing that, and it's just a thing, and if you put like a beep, boop, boop, beep, boop, boop, it's like, it just sounds right. That kind of stuff. But like, I don't get the chance to, I also think it'd be fun to do a Wrath of Khan mini musical. narrated by Q. You know, the kind of thing that could be very easily put on in a 60-minute block at a convention. All these things are really exciting, but right now, I have this very, very unconventional day job, which is in the service of Brentalfloss. But in a way, it's almost like I'm, this is not a woe is me thing I'm saying, it's just the reality of my life. I feel like I'm doing fan fiction of the first 5 years of the Brentalfloss videos now. Does that make sense? Like, I'm kind of, I don't want to say coasting, but it's like, I'm still doing it, but really, most of my favorites are the old classic stuff too. And it's not that I'm gonna like, Brentalfloss never dies, you know what I mean? Pee Wee Herman will never not be Pee Wee Herman. But it may take a little while and be more Paul Rubens this year, and then just do some live shows as Brentalfloss. So I'm mixing it up. But you get what I'm saying. The metaphor is clear. So that said, I want to do a lot of stuff where I basically just take a month and go, this month I'm going to do something totally weird, and maybe it'll make me $1,000 tops. But but it'll be worth it to do because it's something that I really thought would be a cool new challenge instead of, frankly, the challenge that I've been enjoying so much for the last 7 years. The end. Who have I not called on? Yes. Thank you very much. Thanks for coming. Thanks. Is there anything in my life that led to the songs A Dane to Vivi? So I've had moments where I listen to songs that really touch me, and I really want to find out that the person who wrote it had an experience like mine, or that there's something that, like, you know what I mean, that, like, moved them hard. To me, I think it's two things. I played Final Fantasy IX, loved it, loved the character of Vivi so much. To me, it was, I'll be honest, it was my last Final Fantasy that I really liked. That's probably because I played the first ones and I was part of that generation. I remember when I was about 4 years old, I discovered, accidentally, how death worked. Because I discovered the fire alarm, the smoke alarm. And I couldn't wrap my head around why we'd need it if there wasn't going to be a fire. And this is like one of my first vivid, vivid memories of going, and like I freaked out, crying, like just, you know, like a little asshole, like just really keeping my parents awake all night. And I'm sure they lost sleep and were like, oh, this is good. But when I was like, what's this for? And they're like, oh, well, you know, they told me. But I freaked out because, again, what is this for if there's not going to be a fire? Oh, there is a chance of a fire. Well, what the fuck are we doing in this place? We should leave. And then realizing if there were a fire, I would die, and what that is. And when am I going to die? Wait, what do you mean? What? And like, I think probably my dad was just like trying to keep up, but clumsily like being like, well, then you die. I mean, oh no, I've said it now. Like, I freaked out so much figuring out death was a thing. And then I'm sure the next day I woke up and I was like, doop, 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 cereal, you know, whatever. Like, but Vivi in this game finds out the heartbreaking truth that he's basically got like a Final Fantasy, like a fantasy universe version of a terminal illness. And the main character in this game is kind of a swashbuckling bro. Zidane is not a genius. He's just kind of a dude, you know? So what would Zidane say to Vivi to cheer him up that would really be, you know, not profound, but somehow in its simplicity and in its kind of like boneheaded, like, hey, don't think so hard, man, would be the thing Vivi needed to hear. That's where it came from. It wasn't so much an adult trauma, a lasting scar. It was that Vivi reminded me of when I realized I was going to die one day. And somehow what I, with my puppet hand up Zidane's ass, would say to Vivi if I could have. So thanks for the question, and thanks for letting me answer that so elaborately. You on my left, and then maybe you on the right after. Are you asking if Sonic would be a good topic to do with Dave Ballmer? I think yes. In fact, we discussed, I mean, you know, Ocarina was basically like, we knew we wanted to do a sequel to the Mario Land video.
Yeah.
We didn't know what it was going to be, but when I realized that I actually don't care for Ocarina, and he's like, what? That happened in real life? And then I went, fuck Sonic, this is real. That thing we just had, there was a real conversation, that is the song. And of course, we exaggerated greatly. He forgets all the nuance that he sees, and I forget all the nuance I see. But it would be a good idea to do Sonic. To be honest with you, the hardest thing about doing a part three is we cannot really top Ocarina. We're not going to do a 15-minute opus. You say please do. You know it took us 2 years to really get around it, partially because we had to shoot it, but partially because of creative incubation. Sometimes, if you're like, yeah, I've baked this cake, it's good to go. No, you had it in the oven a while, but the temperature was all wrong. Either you made it too hot, now it's burnt, or it hasn't been in there long enough and it's goo. And so Ocarina took 2 years to just be as as perfect as it ended up being, and I'm not saying it was perfect, but as close, right, as it was. So
we can wait.
Our concept, honestly, and this may not happen, so don't count on it. But I think it would be fun if instead of topping it, we just changed, you know, did like apples and oranges, basically. What if, for some sci-fi Star Trek premise reason, we switched brains? So now, when Dave opens his mouth, my voice comes out, and he is acting out Brent, and I am singing Dave and acting out Dave, and in that way we're caricaturing each other, and maybe it's a sci-fi game, maybe if we found some game where this happens, it could tie in, but that's just one possible concept that could be different enough that we still get to do the same kind of sketch, but so that people just don't go, I like Ocarina better, because that's what we've set ourselves up for. We've set ourselves up for somebody going, eh, the first two were good, this is just shite. Anyway, thanks for the question. And I said you were next, yes. Have I played many of the modern Zelda games? I will be honest with you, I have not. I actually have not. I played about half an hour of Twilight Princess. None of Skyward Sword. None of Wind Waker. None of anything after that. And that may be a shock, but the thing is that, like, some people think of me, they just assume that I'm the kind of gamer they are, but I really became a PC gamer right before the GameCube came out. So I didn't want a GameCube because I wanted to be playing Thief on my parents' computer, and Thief 2 and Half-Life and the other Half-Lives and all this stuff. And so I missed the GameCube generation entirely and didn't get a Wii until 2010 when the Brentalfloss thing had been going strong for a year or two. So I have a lot of catching up to do, but sometimes you just kind of want it to be how you had it. And there's no rationality to it. It's just like sometimes, even though you know there's something clunky as hell about postage stamp link walking around a 2D world versus beautiful, gorgeous, you know, I mean, comparatively anyway, Skyward Sword was a very pretty game. But yeah, what was the question, whether I played them? Or whether there's anything I particularly loved or hated about him. I mean, I just remember feeling like what I loved about Zelda was so missing from them, and there was nothing pushing me to keep playing. So it wasn't like, I hate this, I reject these Satan. It was more like, eh. So, sorry to disappoint all you Zelda fans. I am a Zelda fan, just, you know, the 1986 through 1991 Zeldas. All right, you. Yeah, hi. How did I find or meet Demon Tomato Dave? I feel like I just found some of his videos. And here's the thing, I remember telling a friend of mine, yeah, sometimes I see people that are doing this whole lyrics on video games thing, and usually they're just bad. Like, yeah, I'm sure you've seen a knockoff that was just like, I don't mean to be rude, but you know what I mean? Where you're just like, ah, okay, this 11-year-old tried to do this thing and it's cute, but it's just like, they're experimenting. But Dave, even though he wasn't ever imitating me, he was doing similar kind of stuff, and I was like, this guy I like. This is weird, but this is stuff I like. And this was before Smooth McGroove. So he was kind of the only game in town as far as comedy and also a cappella with video games. And I just like this stuff. I don't remember how we started exactly getting in touch, but I remember we'd been friends and contacts, and I think I just asked him to do, at the end of 2010, I asked him if he would do voiceover for my Zelda 2 video. If you guys haven't put it together, in the Zelda 2 with lyrics video, when you hear the guy at the end being like, and so Link did this thing, like, that's Dave. And he released a song at the end of 2011 called Wiggle He 2. None of the words make any sense, but it's a 16-minute a cappella medley of songs such as Tongue Tied from Red Dwarf, Our Little School from The Worst Witch, all of these Christmas songs that are more popular in Britain than the U.S., songs from the Santa Claus movie with Dudley Moore, all of these random things that he just amalgamated, and also some Zelda stuff. that he amalgamated into the 16-minute mega opus, that made me go, if I'm not asking Dave to do a song with me, I'm wasting an opportunity. So I asked him pretty quickly after that if he'd be interested, and that we were at the beginning of 2012, we were actually now working on a project. But it was very gradual and kind of, I don't think we actually friended each other on Facebook till after we'd started writing Mario Land. Because these things take time, and sometimes you don't want to come on too strong. Especially if you kind of have like a, you know, on YouTube, sometimes you have like a jealousy of somebody's stuff, but sometimes you have kind of a weird non-sexual like crush on their work. You really like their work and you don't want them to know how much you like their work. So you're like playing it cool, like, yeah, I was just thinking it might be cool if, you know, we did something one time or whatever, I don't care. Like, you know, it's like you slowly kind of get to know each other. And start collaborating. Am I? Ooh, all right. Is there something in here after this? I'm imagining that, well, actually, what a stupid question. What's happening in 2 minutes is my good friend, Danimal Cannon, who is one of the most talented chiptune composers of all time, is gonna do a show in here. And why I think you should see it is actually not just because of the chiptune part. Chiptune's great, however, and it's fine to be a chiptune guy that sits there and bops your head at a Game Boy, that's cool. But he will turn his Game Boy on and thrash on a guitar over his own compositions in a show that is like no other chiptune act. Please, when you leave this room, have a piss, have a beer, but check out Daniel Cannon's set. I've got time for, I think, one more question, but before I answer it, I will be here all weekend, so if you have a follow-up question, I'll be at my booth in the, I think it's the Queens building?
Yeah.
On and off. If I had Wi-Fi here, I would be tweeting when that happens, but just catch me if you can. And I will have a lot of stuff on the stage as well. Check your schedules. Just one more question, but I will see you guys throughout the weekend. Yes, in the back, drinking out of a horn. What do I think of Castlevania the series? Well, that's really pretty unnuanced, isn't it? I think as a series, Castlevania has some of the best music of any long-lasting franchise. I think 2's bad, I think 1 was revolutionary, I think 3's got my favorite tunes. But, you know, I'll say this, Castlevania as a series is probably the best thing Konami ever did in order to establish themselves as a legitimate, video game company. And somehow, the fuck-ups of the last year have still not undone the greatness that is Castlevania. So thank you so much, guys! Thanks for joining. And definitely check out Danimal Cannon right now. Goodbye.
See ya.